who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. 'Cause you lay down your love, son and daughter, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing. Unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Yeah. Open your Bibles to 1 Thessalonians. We are in chapter 1. Last Sunday we finished Colossians. Now we're starting the letter to the Thessalonians, also written by Paul. When you get to 1 Thessalonians, leave a bookmark there or your bulletin and then go to Acts chapter 17. Acts 17 is going to give us the background of this church, how this church got started. Paul's visit here and what happened. That's Acts 17, verses 1 to 10. Now, this letter was one of the first letters that Paul writes as far as chronology and timing. It's this one in Galatians. Those are the first letters that Paul wrote out. So this is very, very early in his writings. And Paul is writing this church about maybe 2-3 years after they came to Christ. So they're new, they're still new in the faith. But as we go through chapter 1 of Thessalonians, we're going to see that they were very advanced in the faith. That is, they were very well-rounded Christians. And I want you to take note of the characteristics that this church displayed. Now, there are several themes in Thessalonians, first and second, And it was kind of, it took a little bit time for me to narrow it down to one theme to sort of summarize the whole series. And the theme I chose was perseverance in persecution. And that is definitely one theme that we see throughout this letter. But another theme that you're going to notice, especially at the end of every chapter, is an end times theme, an eschatological theme, a looking forward to the coming of Christ. Okay, so there is that theme. Paul wrote this letter to answer certain questions that they had also. One of those questions was, what's going to happen to those that have already died before the coming of Christ? Did they miss out on, you know, the blessing of that? And Paul writes specifically in chapter 4 to address that, talking about the, you know, the catching away of the saints there. We'll talk more about that in a little bit here. So, if you are there, we'll begin reading in verse 1 of chapter 17. It says, "Now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews." This is where the Jews met. This was church for the Jews. "Then Paul, as his custom was, went in to them." We have an actual picture of Paul going in there. Can we show that? It's actually a meme that Joe sent me. There you go. There he is, scoping them out right before he goes in there. I had to show it. Sorry. That was Paul's usual custom. As soon as he went into any city, he would scope out the city, look for the Jews, and he would go to them first, the Bible says. Even though his main office was to the Gentiles, he always wanted, you know, he would give his life for Jews to be saved. And so that's what he does here. It says, we can remove that, that way we're not too distracted with that anymore. It says, "as was his custom, and for 3 Sabbaths reasoned with them from the scriptures." 3 Sabbaths because they met on the Sabbath day, and they allowed Paul to teach, and he would teach them, and he would reason with them. He was trying to show them Jesus in the Old Testament. Verse 3, "explaining and demonstrating that the Christ had to suffer and rise again from the dead, and saying, 'This Jesus whom I preach to you is the Christ. He is the Messiah.'" You see, the Jews were looking for the Savior that was going to come to dominate the world, to take over, to, you know, destroy the Romans and establish the new kingdom. That Jesus is still yet to come, but they neglected the verses of the suffering Messiah that spoke about him, you know, dying, that spoke about him being a suffering servant. That wasn't a very popular Messiah, so they neglected those verses and they overemphasized the ones. They got ahead of themselves, always looking for the Messiah that was going to reign and conquer. And that's one of the reasons that they rejected Jesus when he came. So Paul is trying to give him the gospel and teach him that Christ needed to die. He needed to suffer and rise again from the dead. Verse 4, "And some of them were persuaded," that means they came to the faith, "and a great multitude of the devout Greeks and not a few of the leading women," that means a lot of them, "and not a few of them joined Paul and Silas. But the Jews who were not persuaded, becoming envious, took some of the evil men from the marketplace and, gathering a mob, set all the city in an uproar and attacked the house of Jason and sought to bring them out to the people. But when they did not find them, they dragged Jason and some of the brethren to the rulers of the city, crying out," notice this, this was meant to be an insult, but it's a praise, "these who have turned the world upside down have come here too. This is a recognition of how far the gospel had gone, how many lives it had touched. To the world, the Christian is living backwards. But the reality is that we're living the right way. The world has been living backwards since day one, since Adam and Eve fell. But that's how they saw Paul and them, as turning everything upside down. Yet it was a recognition that the gospel was advancing. Verse 7 says, "Jason has harbored them," they said, "and these are all acting contrary to the decrees of Caesar." So they were instigating a riot among the Gentiles, saying, "There is another king, Jesus." And they troubled the crowd and the rulers of the city when they heard these things. Verse 9, "So when they had taken security from Jason," that means when they've taken money from Jason and the rest, "they let them go." Verse 10, last verse, "Then the brethren immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea. When they arrived, they went into the synagogue of the Jews." This is what I want you to notice. Paul was only there for a matter of no more than 3 weeks, but he was able to establish a church there. And even within that time, things got heated. There was a commotion. There was persecution. So now Paul is writing them back 2-3 years later, and there's still commotion. There's still persecution. Why? Because people are still getting saved, because things are still, by their view, things were still turning upside down. So keep that in mind, because a big theme here is perseverance under persecution. So let's begin now. If you can turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. It says, Paul, Silvanus, or Silas, and Timothy, to the church of the Thessalonians in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. This is not a normal greeting. There is theology behind every word that Paul wrote down. When he refers to this church as being in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, he's going back to what Jesus said in the Gospel of John, of how his sheep are in the Lord's hands, and then he says that they are in his hands and nobody can take them out of his hands. Okay, my sheep hear my voice and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they shall never perish, says the Bible. No one can take them out of my hands. And that's sort of what he's addressing here. He's saying, you guys are the security of being in God's hands here. Paul is going to tell them or encourage them that he knows that they are elect, that they are called of God. And he doesn't just say that to them for no reason because they made a profession 2-3 years ago, but because he had heard about their faith, he saw that they were well-rounded Christians now. He says, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Note, apart from grace, we cannot have peace. Grace is the cause, peace is the effect. When God has given us grace, everything else is going to flow from that, okay? The peace of God that surpasses all understanding that Paul told the Philippians about is a sort of that peace, if you will. Verse 2 says, we give thanks to God always for you all, making mention of you in our prayers, remembering without ceasing. Notice these three things, the triad of the faith. Work of faith, he says, labor of love, and patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of our God and Father, knowing, beloved brethren, here it is, your election by God. How do we know if we are elect of God? Well, what is the fruit in our life? Have we responded positively to the gospel yet? If so, then there's going to be a lived out confession. It's not just going to be some profession we made in summer camp years back or at some church or Greg Laurie, you know, Harvest Crusade. But what is happening in my life now? Is there work of faith here? Is there this patient hope? Is there labor of love? So our first, if you're taking notes, I want you to write down, number one, a ripple travels outwardly because of something that traveled inwardly. A ripple travels outwardly because of something that traveled inwardly. When you throw a stone in the water, the stone goes down, it submerges into the water, but it causes a ripple effect on the outside, right? The bigger the stone, the bigger the ripple effect. And what I mean by this is, when the Holy Spirit enters a person truly, there you cannot stay the same. There's going to be a change on the outside when the Holy Spirit enters you, right? It happened with Paul. I mean, when Paul came to Christ, it was a pretty dramatic event in Acts chapter 9. He was on his way. It was a total U-turn, right? He was on his way to persecute the church, and the Lord totally humbled him. He is a very independent man. And the Lord humbles him, he loses his sight temporarily, and he's led as a child by the hand into the city now. The Lord humbled the man before he could use the man. Yet now he's being persecuted. Now he's not the persecutor. But notice his zeal, his fervor for the Lord never changed. It just changed direction. The temperature was always there, the direction is the thing that changed. Now he's serving the Lord. So he mentions these three things: work of faith, labor of love, patience of hope. Let's break those down. Work of faith. A true faith is a working faith, okay? But it's important to take note that we are not saved because of works, okay? Works proceed from true faith. We're not working to get something, we are working from something. So just like peace proceeds from grace, so too works proceed from faith. Okay? Those whom God chooses, God changes. That's our first point. Those whom God chooses, God changes. So there's going to be change in our lives, and one of those changes is the byproduct of true faith. Now, if you haven't read the book of James, I highly encourage you to read the book of James, because there James is talking to a people who were kind of idle in their faith, who made a profession, but there was no real evidence in their life. And that's why he says, even the demons believe and they tremble. See, biblical Christianity, the Bible does not teach that salvation comes because somebody, you know, does the tip of a hat or makes a mental ascent or says some doctrine or agrees to, you know, some theological truth, because there's a lot of people that have head knowledge, but they don't know Christ yet, okay? So the Pharisees, for example, they had a lot of head knowledge. They knew the scriptures. But when God was with them face to face, they rejected him completely. So it's important that we examine ourselves and see if we have any of these things. See if our faith is working. If we have a working faith, a faith that produces fruit. Because that's really where the change is evidenced. Number two, love produces labor. Love produces labor. This is a laboring love. But I want you to note that the Greek word for work and the Greek word for labor are two different things. They do not mean the same thing. When you read the word in the Greek for labor, it means it can be used for a beating. It can be used for enduring under a lot of pressure. So this kind of love that we're talking about here, this laborious love, is sort of like the one that Paul mentions in 1 Corinthians 13 when he's saying love suffers long, right? Love endures all things. That's the kind of love, and it goes back to the agape love that we see in Jesus Christ displayed, right? God didn't just stick his head out of the clouds and said, I love you guys, be good, I'll see you when you get here. He sent his son, right? He sends his son to die on the cross for our sins, and that's what love looks like. John 3:16 is a bloody verse. That's a reality. It for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, for whosoever believes in him, should not perish, but have eternal life or everlasting life. That's the truth. He suffered, but he suffered because of love. And that should be evident in our lives as well. So, two things so far. Working faith, okay, check. And then a laborious love. A question for us is, do I truly love my neighbor? Do I truly love those around me? Before I came to Christ, I can tell you that I love myself. How do I know I love myself? Because I fed myself, right? I took care of myself. It was about me, myself, and I. It was the unholy trinity. Me, myself, and I. Everything was about me. It's about my needs, meeting my needs, and so on. And listen, even though we take care of ourselves still as believers, it's no longer about us. It's about God, and it's about others. And that's really the whole Bible summarized, okay? That was the law, by the way, if you don't know this. The Ten Commandments, they are the first four commandments are God-word, and the last six are man-word. If we're doing the first right, the second is going to be easier to do. If we're really loving God, we're going to love our neighbors as ourselves. And listen, it's going to be seen as we suffer under persecution. True faith is the love of God in us seen by the labor of love through us. That's our next point. True faith is the love of God in us seen by the labor of love through us. See, the Bible says, and I'm sure 90% of you know this verse, God is what? God is love. He is true love, right? If we're going to define what love is today, in today's culture, because love has been hijacked, that word has been hijacked, people have added different meanings to that, but if we're going to see what love really looks like, we've got to look at the character and the person of Christ. Jesus said, when his disciples asked him, when are you going to show us the Father? Jesus is like, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father, been with you, right? And God is love, and the Holy Spirit is God, and the Holy Spirit lives inside of us. And so what is the fruit of the Holy Spirit? Galatians 5, right? It's love. The fruit of the Spirit is love. I would say, because notice it's in the singular. It's in the singular, so he starts off love, joy, peace. I would say it's really love and all the characteristics of love laid out in our lives. So your character is going to change and you're going to be able to resist. You're not going to be easy to anger when you are walking in the Spirit. True faith is the love of God in us, seen by the labor of love through us. So what's the third evidence of election? Patient hope. Patient hope. This is the third ripple, if you will. This patient hope is a hope that does not look down at the circumstance, but it looks up towards heaven, towards Jesus. Often we make the mistake, and I do this all the time. It's a different thing preaching to you, and then being actually going through a trial, right? We might have the head knowledge, but somehow we get, you know, amnesia during that time, selective amnesia, and it just, you know, instead of praying, we're complaining. We're like, Lord, where are you? And we fail to see him in our trials. So when Jesus walked to Peter, what was happening? On the water. When Jesus walked to Peter on the water, what was happening? There was a storm, right? The storm did not go away because Jesus went to them. They were still in the middle of a storm. Peter, at first, seems kind of like, well, they thought it was a ghost. And then they find out it's the Lord. But then Peter's like, I'm not going to go unless you call me, right? And Jesus is like, well, come. So Peter went. He was walking on water, no doubt, but he was walking on God's word. He was walking in obedience. He's walking in the right direction. He's walking towards Jesus. But what's the problem after that? He took his eyes off of Jesus, and what happens? He sinks, right? And that is a beautiful principle that we need to be reminded about. When we take our eyes off of Jesus, we might be following Jesus. We might be going to church. We might not be backsliding. But if we take our eyes off of Jesus, we will be discouraged. We will find ourselves in a place where we have to pray the shortest prayer, Lord help, right? And that's it. And it's beautiful because that passage teaches us God's grace. It teaches us that, hey, you know, though we might be able to do some things with the Lord's help, at the end of the day, we need grace upon grace. So where am I getting at with this? This patient hope that the Bible talks about is a hope that keeps its eyes on Jesus. Because see, that's the key, right? The key is understanding that Jesus is with us in the circumstances and keeping our eyes on him. It's about perspective when it comes to perseverance. Here's our next point. The key to perseverance is where our eyes are, not where we are. Where our eyes are, not where we are. That's what's going to make the difference. Because the Lord is not going to take you out. Most of the time, I would say, 9 out of 10 times, you're going to pray about getting out of some trial. But God's like, I'm not going to get you out of it. I'm not going to keep you from it. I'm going to get you through it. You're going to get from point A to point B, but you're going to go straight through. Because see, that moment when Jesus walked on water, right before, he sent them by boat across the lake. He could have said, you guys can walk around because there's a storm that's coming. He knew the storm was coming. He actually pushed him out into the boat. The Greek there was sort of kind of like a forceful word. You're going on this trip. So, but the idea here is to keep our eyes on the Lord, and we will be able to get through. Now, I haven't done this illustration in a while. I think it's been 4 years now. I need a pretty able, fit guy. Is Aaron Wonders here? Aaron Wonders, are you here? Well, Andrew, you want to come over here? Some of you guys have seen this illustration already, but it's a good reminder. Andrew, you want to grab that broom right there? So, Andrew, you want to balance the broom, and at first we're going to count with you, but you're going to balance it, and you're going to keep your eyes on the bottom at the root, and we're going to count. Ready? You're going to try to balance it as long as you can. Keep your eyes on your hands there at the bottom. You can't hold it, though. Go. 1, 2, 3. Let's give him another chance. Go ahead, Andrew. Go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, that's better. All right, now do it. Now do it looking up, looking at the top of the broom. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So what was easier? Looking up. Yeah, look at that. I mean, it's usually a youth Sunday school lesson, but you guys get it. We need that. Thank you, Andrew. I'll call you back in 4 years with the Lord tarries. Andrew did it 4 years ago. All right, so we need to be well-rounded Christians. We need to keep working in faith. We need to... walk in this labor of love, and we need to keep our eyes on Jesus, a hope that waits on him. So the next thing to write down is a ripple circumference is dependent on the power of its center. A ripple circumference is dependent on the power of its center. What do I mean by that? Well, a Christian can only go as far as the Holy Spirit will take him or her, okay? The reason a ripple is caused is because something goes inside of the water. Likewise, the Holy Spirit is the one that really wills through us. He's the one that strengthens us. He's the one that gets us through. So Paul could have said, he could have gone to the city and he could have been like very sure of himself. And he could have said, well, I used to be a Pharisee, you know, from the tribe of Benjamin, studied under Gamaliel and all these things. He could have said, this is a piece of cake. I'm going to reach all these Jews for Jesus. And he didn't do that. He never does that. He always depends on the Holy Spirit. Because he knows that the people need to trust in Jesus, not him. Because he's not gonna stay with them. He didn't stay with them. He was only there for 2-3 weeks, right? And they needed to depend on the Holy Spirit, but they needed to see them depending on the Holy Spirit first. Look at verse 5 and 6. He says, for our gospel did not come to you in word only. I wasn't just preaching to you. It wasn't just my persuasiveness, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and in much assurance. It's the Holy Spirit that gave him the confirmation and assurance. He says in verse 5, as you know what kind of men we were among you for your sake, and you became followers. Notice the order of us and of the Lord. It was their dependent example on the Holy Spirit that motivated them to depend on Jesus Christ. And that's what it really goes back to. Am I allowing my talk to harmonize with my walk? Is my life evidencing a dependency on the Holy Spirit? One of the verses that I love is found in 1 Corinthians 2, 4-5. And I think Paul lays it out a little bit more descriptively here. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 4 and 5 says, excuse me, and my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, notice, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith, here's the reason, should not be in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. You don't need for me to put the cookies in the top, you know, cabinet. The gospel, the word of God is clear, and it should be made clear, okay? Paul did not try to persuade them to be followers of Paul. He tried to persuade them to be followers of Jesus, but in doing so, they followed him, leading to following Christ. That's why Paul says elsewhere, follow me as I follow Christ. And that's the idea here. When you are led of the Spirit, others will be led by the Spirit. When you are led of the Spirit, others will be led by the Spirit. But it's got to be evident in our life. You don't want to be a dead church, and you don't want to go to a dead church where it's a lot of, you know, it's no longer a fire. It's just motion. It's like an old fabric, just going with the flow. A lot of, you know, the doctrine is there, the theology is there, but the Spirit seems to be missing. You don't want that either. What you want is to be led of the Spirit. And listen, the Holy Spirit does not contradict his word. The word is inspired by the Holy Spirit. So the things that the Spirit leads us to do are going to go in line with what he has already told us through his infallible word. Why? Because the Holy Spirit is not schizophrenic. He does not contradict himself. So you want to be led by the Spirit, but you also want to be led by the word, and it goes hand in hand. Because you are led of the Spirit, when you are led of the Spirit, others will be led by the Spirit. Here's another one, 2 Corinthians 3, 5, and 6. Not that we are sufficient of ourselves, to think anything as being from ourselves, but our sufficiency is from God, who also made us sufficient as ministers of the new covenant. Here it is again, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. Always going back to the Spirit and sufficiency in the Lord. It ain't you, it's God through you. Now, we're still talking on the subject of the Holy Spirit in our lives. But another thing to note here is that the Holy Spirit is also going to give us the necessary tools to get through difficulty. The Holy Spirit is going to give you the things that you need for the things that God has called you. Look at verse 6 again, the middle of verse 6. Having received the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Spirit. Okay? Not happiness that comes from emotions, right? Not bubbly feelings. Not emotionalism, but the joy that comes from the Holy Spirit. Notice how they get they receive the good news, but with the good news came bad news. Oh, you're saved now. Well, you're going to get excommunicated from the synagogue. Families were separate. Back then, it was a pretty big deal, and it happens today too as well. Usually in cults, when you are part of a cult, and you accept Jesus, you do get sort of banned. You know, there's people that even they'll fire you if in the community of a certain cult, they'll fire you if you become a Christian. They'll tell others, oh, don't talk to them, stay away from them, and so on. And that's what Jesus meant when he says, I didn't come to bring peace, I came to bring a sword between father and wife and son and mother. It's talking about the fact that when you truly accept and start to follow Jesus, when you leave the idols, you know what? Family's going to leave you. Family is going to leave you. Family is going to shun you. And listen, it might not happen the way like I mentioned with the cults, but it will happen in the sense that they ain't going to invite you no more to those get-togethers. For me, it's a relief because I don't like being around family. I'm more of an introvert, you know, and really I don't want to be around the things that used to cause me to stumble. So in Christ I have a family. In Christ I seek the fellowship with the body of Christ. Look at how the Century English Version renders this part. You suffered, but the Holy Spirit made you glad. That's verse 6. You suffered, but the Holy Spirit made you glad. And that's what I mean by you're going to go through stuff, but God is going to give you the tools to get through the stuff. And that is joy, the joy of the Spirit. The joy of the Spirit has been likened to the ocean floor. The waves of the sea might be dependent on the wind, but the ocean floor is not going to move. And that's the joy. Feelings come and go. I know I'm not always happy. I know you're not always happy. We're not always glad and so on. But our joy should remain constant and found in Christ Jesus. So what's the other thing that we can learn from this? Especially here where it says, receive the word in much affliction. Well, another thing we can learn is that true faith will be tested. True faith will be tested. A faith to be proven true has a fire to go through. Even if you just make a profession to Christ, by God's grace, he's going to test that profession as well. We see this example in the parable of the four soils. In the parable of the four soils, only one of the four actually produces fruit. In my opinion, I think only one of the four was truly ever saved. The first one, the Bible says that the seed is the word of God, the gospel, it falls on the hard ground. That's the person, the birds of the air come and take it away. It never permeates the ground. It never germinates. It never goes. It stays up here on the surface. Okay? It just goes in one ear and out the other. Happens all the time. Then you have the other ground, the thorny ground, the ground that was occupied, that shared, the soil that shared itself with the worries of life, with distractions, right? Oh, that seemed to grow, and it grew a little bit, but then it was choked out by the cares of life, the Bible says. And then you have the stony ground. Stony not because there was a bunch of stones there, but because there was these limestones, these big rocks close to the surface of the earth that only allowed for a little bit of soil there. It was enough for something to grow really fast, but it would never grow deep. Therefore, as fast as it grew, that's as fast as it died. Because as soon as the sun came out, it killed it. Now, the sun is not the bad guy, is it? The sun gives life to the plant. Trials, sufferings give us life. It tests our faith, as James says. We'll look at that verse in a little bit. So the sun is not the bad guy, but the sun is going to test if you truly are rooted in Christ. Okay? So therefore, the fourth one is the one that produced, 60-fold, 80-fold, and 100-fold. The sun did not destroy it. The sun gave it life. It's like, Superman, right? His strength is the sun. The more, rays from the sun, the stronger he gets. And that's the idea here. That's the picture behind this. A faith to be proven true has a fire to go through. I mean, we see this with in Daniel chapter 3 with Radshak, Meshach, and Abednego. Nebuchadnezzar, what does he do? He erects an idol, and he's like, all right, everybody, you got to worship this idol. You got to bow down and worship it. What do Radshak, Meshach, and Abednego do? They refuse, right? They stand. So what was the consequence of standing up for their faith in God? They're thrown into the fire, a fiery furnace that was so hot, the guy throwing them in there dies. but they don't die, right? They throw three in there, and then they look into the fire furnace, and they see the Lord. They see the Lord there. And that's a picture of true faith that is tested by fire. It refuses to be in the shade without Jesus. It wants to stand for the Lord. And they said it themselves in that chapter. It's like, well, if we die, we're not trusting God, but if we die, we die. If not, you know, praise the Lord. And that's the idea. A true faith will be tested by trials, by persecution. James 1:2-4 says it. My brethren, count it all what? Joy. When you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces, it's coming from patience, let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. We should not be confused about this. God wants us to be well-rounded Christians. God wants us to be perfect and complete. It doesn't mean sinless, okay? Because I understand we're going to sin, but God still wants us to walk in holiness. Be holy, for I am holy, Leviticus chapter 19 tells us. Here in the New Testament, in Matthew, I think I have that verse too. Jesus says in Matthew, to be perfect as my Father in heaven is perfect. So that's the idea. God wants us to be well-rounded Christians. So, in summary, joy is a byproduct of something, the Holy Spirit in us and the trials outside of us. That's how it works. They work together. God is going to give us what we need to pull through. So, number three now, some ripples are actually big waves. Some ripples are actually big waves. The Thessalonians were an example. They stood out among all the churches of their time, their peers. It wasn't that they didn't mess up, but the reality is that they were like the Church of Philadelphia with the open door. They spread the gospel pretty fast. Within a matter of 2-3 years, everyone knew about their testimony already. And this is not just my opinion. This is actually what Paul is saying here in verse 7. He says, so that you became examples to all in Macedonia and Achaia who believe. So Macedonia is the northern part of Greece. Achaia is the southern part of Greece. What Paul is saying is like, dude, you guys have left your mark in everyone in Greece, the north and the south. And he's about to tell us in a little bit, not just in Greece, but everywhere else. He says in verse 8, for from you the word of the Lord has sounded forth, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place. Your faith toward God has gone out. This word, if we can go back to the word here, examples, in verse 7, that word examples actually means, in the Greek, a seal or a stamp. So what he's literally saying here is, you have left your mark on other people. And I find that interesting because I then have to ask myself, how am I leaving my mark on others? You know, the mark of the Lord on other people. How am I leaving an impression? Are people walking away from me assuming that I'm just a good moral person? Are they walking away from me assuming that, you know what, I'm just, you know, I go to church? Or that I'm just a normal person, happy-go-lucky person? How are people walking away from? Do people know that we truly are changed? That the same Spirit that rose Jesus from the dead is actually dwelling inside of us? Verse 8 says that the word of the Lord sounded forth. This is an interesting word as well because it means to reverberate. It means to like a speaker. It just goes forth. But back then there was not social media. There wasn't airwaves. There wasn't television, email, none of that stuff. How did the word sound forth? Well, by them going forth. That was the only way. And I would say this is the most successful way still today. You know, relationships, one-on-one, talking to people. I understand you can post a verse here and there on Facebook or Instagram. I understand that. I'm not discouraging you from doing that. But at the end of the day, we have to establish relationships. Relationships are more powerful in influencing people because it has the element of them seeing. It's not just you posting something or saying something. It's them seeing the example in our life. It's reading the Bible that is ourselves before they actually open up their own Bibles. See, faith in God is seen when it is heard. Faith in God is seen when it is heard. And that's what Paul meant when he said in Romans, faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. But I have to go. In that same chapter, he says, you know what? How are they going to hear? How are they going to believe unless somebody goes unless they are sent? It's so important that we support missionaries, that we send missionaries. But I would say more importantly is the understanding that we are missionaries where we're at right now. We all have been given the Great Commission to reach people. Your faith toward God has gone forth. They were the example. Notice in verse 8, he praises them again, so that we do not need to say anything. In other words, you guys are doing all the evangelizing. Every time we get to some place, they already heard your testimony. They've already heard what God has done in your life. He says in verse 9, for they themselves declare concerning us what manner of entry we had to you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God. See, they gave people their testimony. You don't need to know all the answers. You don't need to know about the prime mover or the argument of this or that, or what. You don't need to listen to William Lane Craig to be able to give a sound rebuttal to some atheist or somebody who's asking you why you believe what you believe. You do need to know the gospel, because that's what Romans 1, 16 and 17 tells us. That's where the power is at. And for the most part, I mean, really, the reality is, I'm not going to be preaching the gospel if I don't know the gospel. I'm not going to be trying to get people saved if I'm not saved myself, right? So every one of us is equipped. If you're a believer, if you know what the Lord has turned you from, to share it with other people, right? Sometimes we think, man, well, if I'm not a drug addict, if I wasn't a drug addict or a womanizer or a drunker, then I can't really minister to these guys over here in the street. But that's not true. See, Paul was an ex-Pharisee. He had a lot of relation to the Jews, but when he went to go preach to them in Jerusalem, they didn't listen to him. See, because it wasn't about Paul. This is the same point. It wasn't about Paul. It's about the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit can use a nerdy guy to go reach some thug outside or vice versa. It doesn't matter, because it goes back to the Holy Spirit. It goes back to His grace, to His grace. And I understand, finding bridges, it's good. But listen, this is what Paul said. I am all things to all men, to those under the law as if under the law, to those not under the law, as not being under the law. All things to all men. It doesn't mean you're going to be fake and try to fake the funk and try to talk a certain way that you don't talk, because people are gonna see that. They're gonna know when you're not being true. But we need to have a heart for people. I always pray to God, Lord, give me a heart for people. Give me the heart that you have for them, because if I don't have that heart, I'm not gonna do anything with my faith. Number 4 and last verse here. Ripples move on the reflection of the sky. What do I mean by that? A believer's motivation is the return of Jesus for them. A ripple, is gonna move across a lake or an ocean, but the ocean or the lake is always reflecting the sky. Going back to this patient hope. In verse 10, he's telling us about the coming of Jesus Christ and how they were motivated, looking forward to that coming of the Lord. But this coming of the Lord is not the second coming. It's not the coming of the Lord to the earth to establish His kingdom. It's the coming of the Lord to the clouds to take up His saints. Okay, this is referring to the rapture of the church. Look at what it says in verse 10, and to wait for His Son from heaven, whom He raised from the dead, even Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. Heaven is not just a place we go to. It's a place we are motivated by. It's not just a destination, but a motivation. And that was their motivation to keep going forward, to suffer under persecution. The coming of the Lord, the soon return of Jesus Christ. And it's important that we brush up on our end times. Sometimes we try to stay away from it because there's a few views and all that. But the reality is that Jesus is coming back, and He's coming back for His bride. So it's important that we not neglect these verses and understand that He has not appointed us to wrath. He's talking about a specific time period, what we call the tribulation period, the 7-year tribulation period. The time of Jacob's trouble as well. We have the tribulation period. It gets worse after the 3.5 years, but it's still it's there, it's difficulty, and God is going to pull his people out before that happens. Look at one verse in Revelation 3:10, talking to the church of Philadelphia, the church that goes and evangelizes. Because you have kept my command to persevere, I also will keep you from, the Greek is ek, meaning out, the hour of trial. Hour of trial means a certain time period that the church is going to be kept out of, which shall come upon, notice, the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. Those who dwell on the earth is a synonym for unbelievers. Earthly people is what he's trying to say. And there's going to come a time. Listen, the church has always gone through persecution, especially during that, right after the apostles died, those first 10 centuries under the 10 Roman rulers, millions of people died, millions of Christians died. You've seen the movies, thrown into the lions and the Colosseum and all that. A bunch of stuff happened. Caesar blamed the Christians for the fires in Rome there. They made them into human candles and all kinds of suffering, okay? Now, at that time, they could have said, well, we're going through the tribulation. We're going through a difficult time. But the Bible says it's going to be like, no, it hasn't been seen before. So it's going to be a lot worse than that, especially during the 3.5 years and after. But the idea here is that this is a deliverance from a wrath to come. The Lord is going to deliver his church because he's going to keep his promises to Israel. God is not done with Israel. Read Romans chapter 11. He's going to bring his people back to his fold. Right now they have the blinders on. But during this time, when he takes his bride, when he takes us with him, he's going to focus on the earth. Specifically, he's going to turn his eye to go back to the apple of his eyes, Jerusalem there and the Jews. And a lot of them are going to die, a good third of them. And during that time, when they recognize this is the temple is going to be built already and they're going to start sacrificing again. Yeah, by the way, they already have plans for that. When I was there last time, 2 years ago, they, you know, underground, they're doing all the excavation. They're getting everything ready and all that. But there's a mosque on top of it. So what do you think is going to happen when they remove the mosque? You know, there's going to be, you know, it's going to be the cup of trembling that the Bible talks about. Well, either way, during this time, the Jews are going to go into the wilderness. That's what the Bible talks about. And it's during that time, at the culmination of that time, that they're going to recognize that Jesus is truly the Messiah. And that's when Jesus actually comes back with his church. Not for his church, okay? Look at those passages in the Bible as well. We'll have plenty of time to talk about that as we continue through this book. But that's the reality. We got to live in the future tense, being motivated by the imminent return of Jesus Christ. Every other view causes you to take your eyes off of Jesus coming soon, because every other view says, well, this needs to happen first and that needs to happen first before Jesus comes, because they don't see the difference between the second coming and the rapture of the church. But the reality is that there's a difference. I wouldn't be hopeful if I'm looking for the Antichrist to come or for this to happen or that to happen. No, the imminency of Jesus Christ is at any moment. Now, some might say, well, Albert, that was almost 2,000 years ago. They were waiting for him. He didn't come. Well, all that means is that we're 2,000 years closer to the coming of Jesus Christ. And we should allow this motivation to cause us to be on fire for Jesus, right? I think somebody said the motto of the Christian church right now is, Lord Jesus, come, but not yet. Because I still want to do this and I want to do that. And we have this sense of, sometimes we have this sense of a lack of empathy, sympathy. We can be indifferent. But when we're on fire for the coming, when we think Jesus is coming tomorrow, we're going to live like today is the last day. We're going to keep short accounts with God. We're not going to be messing around with sin. We're not going to be playing church, being lukewarm. We're not going to do that. If we are looking, if we think Jesus is coming tomorrow, we're not going to be playing with the Lord today. So what are some examples as the ushers start passing out the communion elements? What are some examples of the rapture in the Old Testament? So God gives us types. If you follow us on YouTube or if you join us on Wednesday nights, we're going through the book of Leviticus. But Leviticus is really about Jesus. Everything points future to the future. The veil that was torn in two tells us the New Testament, Hebrew says that was a picture of Jesus. The high priest is a picture of Jesus, right? I said last week that the prayers, the incense, the burning prayers, that's a picture of our prayers going to the Father. There's a lot of types and pictures in the Bible. Well, one of the types of the rapture, the pre-trib rapture before judgment, is the life of Enoch and what happens to Enoch. In Genesis, we read that Enoch walked with God, but then he was not, for God took him. Enoch is the only other guy in the Bible that we read about, Enoch and Elijah, that have not yet experienced death. So Enoch was taken up to heaven, the Bible tells us. But the key here is when. Enoch was taken up to heaven before God judged the whole world with the global flood, right? That is a picture of the pre-trib rapture. His church is taken, those that walk with God are taken, and judgment comes on the earth. But there are those on the earth that get spared or saved through the judgment. You get where I'm going with this? Noah and his family did not die in the waters of the flood. They were spared through the ark, right? So what is the ark a picture of? What is the ark a picture of? Jesus, okay? It's a picture of Jesus. Even that word in the Hebrew pitch, it means atonement, okay? So here we see a picture of a specific people being saved through judgment, and that's the Jews. So we see all these pictures, we see all these things, and I just want to encourage you, closing up here before we start communion, to look up, because your redemption, our redemption draws near. Be motivated by that. Live in the future tense, because as 1 Thessalonians 4:18 says, comfort one another with these words. Comfort one another with these words. What words? The soon return of Jesus Christ. We are about to partake in Holy Communion. We do this here once a month. But the Bible says, whenever you do it, remember that this is a remembrance, a memorial service of his death for us, how he gave his body and his blood for us. When we do this, we are also proclaiming his death, guess what, till he comes again. Even communion is looking towards the forward to the imminency of the return of Jesus Christ. Let's look at these verses in 1 Corinthians 11, 23. 1 Corinthians 11:23 say, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread." That's why we have the cracker. It was flat bread. "And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" See, when you're doing this, you're not eating it and all of a sudden your sins from the weekend are being forgiven. This is a memorial service. It's just in remembrance. "In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and the blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak, ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves truly, we would not be judged." We take that to mean that we need to take communion with the right heart. If you're not saved, please take this moment of examination to say, "Lord, I'm a sinner. I need you. I repent of my sins now. I trust in you. I'm going to give up my idols today. I want your grace, Lord. I want you to come into my heart. I believe that you died and that you rose again on the third day." If you do that truly, the Bible says if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart, you will be saved. And that you could take God's word to the bank there. But another way, if you're a believer already, to take communion in a worthy manner is to make sure that you're not practicing sin. Leave your sin at the door. Say, if there's something you've been harboring, unforgiveness, sin, whatever, let's leave that at the door during this moment. Let's take a time to repent and examine our hearts before we partake together. Lord, bring to our hearts anything that is not of you, anything we need to let go of, Lord. Any hidden sin, anything we've been ignoring, I pray, Lord, that you bring it to our minds so we can truly just let it go and obey what the Bible says. If you confess your sins, he is faithful and just to forgive you of your sins. Thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you, Lord, for dying, for sending your son to die for our sins. Help us not to forget the simplicity of the gospel, Christ and him crucified. So we thank you now, Lord, before we partake, for your body, which you gave for us, and for your blood, which you shed for us. Let us partake. Amen.